Hi there. Now, I hope everyone's okay. What I'm going to do is just quickly introduce you to this topic that we're going to look at now on Beethoven's music. Now, why Beethoven? Why classical music? Well, because it's really important to understand that there is a load of amazing, great classical music out there to listen to. And I could have picked all sorts of different composers, but in 2020, there's a big celebration into Beethoven's anniversary of his birth 250 years ago this year. So Beethoven was born in December 1770, making it 250 years this year since he was born. So there's a lot of Beethoven in sort of cultural circles at the moment. A lot of people speak about his music and listen to his music, and so it feels appropriate that we should study it. And even if it's not 2020, he's one of the seminal composers, most important composers ever walked on the planet. So he's well worth studying. So what we're going to do in this first video is look a little bit at his life and some of his compositions, and just to try and find out a little bit more about who he was, and also to put him into a historical context with regard to other composers that came before him and influenced him as well. So that's in this first part. So Beethoven's born in 1770. And he's born in a city called Bonn, which is in the west of Germany, as you can see from the map here. And he's born into quite a musical family. So his grandfather was a professional musician, talented musician. His father wasn't musical, but he was very ambitious on behalf of his son. So Mozart, who was a composer who was born in 1756, so a little bit earlier than Beethoven, had really like swept across Europe with his fame as a child musician. And Beethoven's father wanted his son to be the new Mozart, a sort of a musical prodigy, a sort of musical genius as a child, and that's the ambition that he held for his son. Mention Mozart there. I think it's important that we understand the sort of pantheon of great composers through the 18th and into the early 19th century. So first of all, we're going to meet very briefly Antonio Vivaldi. So he is a Baroque composer from the Baroque period of music, and he dies in 1741. He's Italian. He writes lots of operas, lots of string music, and the Four Seasons is probably his most famous piece, and I reckon you recognize it. Here's a quick snippet of it. At around the same time, we have J.S. Bach. So Bach is a German composer who dies in 1750. He writes all sorts of important music for the church, for keyboards, for orchestras. He's and wrote well over 1,000 pieces during his lifetime. He's a very prolific composer. And here's a little bit of a keyboard piece that he wrote. That's a very famous piece of music, again, more commonly played in the piano now. I've heard it used in lots of adverts, so you may have come across that or recognize that. And then finally, we have from the late Baroque period, Handel, who is a German composer again, but lives in England for most of the second half of his life. And he writes lots of what are called oratorios. An oratorio is a little bit like an opera, but with a religious story. And the Messiah is probably his most famous piece of music, and I reckon you recognize a little bit of the Messiah. This is his Hallelujah chorus. I've
referred to the word Baroque when I'm talking about those three composers, and you think of music a little bit like the kings and queens of England, for instance, in different sort of like periods or eras. The difference between kings and queens is that when the last of one family dies out, say the Tudors, and Queen Elizabeth dies in 1603, you know that that's the end of that period, and then up starts the next period when the next ruling family comes to the fore, which in 1603 was James I. He was a Stuart, a Scot. In music, it's not so clear cut. The Baroque period's thought to finish sort of sometime around the 1750s. Maybe 1760. Handel dies in 1759, so that's a convenient cut-off point. But it's not like on the 1st of January in 1760, everyone woke up and thought, right, okay, musicians, we're in a new period of music now, let's all write in a different style. These things happen and more gradually and evolve. But definitely in a more modern style back then than these three composers, we have our two classical composers who, along with Beethoven, become the sort of like greats of the classical era of music. So first of all, we have Mozart, who, as I mentioned before, was a child prodigy, wrote his first piece age four, and wrote prolifically, even though he was only 35 when he died. And here's a little snippet of a bit of music by him. This is the overture from his opera, The Marriage of Figaro. And again, this is a really famous piece of orchestral music. Also, at the same time, got Haydn with him, who is another hugely famous composer. So Mozart, I should have said, is Austrian. Haydn, Austrian as well, but lives in Hungary for a lot of his life before moving to Paris and London towards the end of his life. And Haydn dies in 1809. Now, Haydn's really important because he actually teaches Beethoven composition before he dies. And this is a little snippet of Haydn from his Surprise Symphony. And there you have the surprise chord at the end. So Haydn there dying in 1809. So I just remind you Beethoven's dates. He's born in 1770 and he dies in 1827. So he's sort of following on in the footsteps of these great composers who lived in Germany, Austria and Italy during the sort of middle part and late part of the 18th century into the 19th century. So Beethoven, as I mentioned before, was born in Bonn, and here is his house and his piano that he played in Bonn. Now, the reason I put these this up here is just out of interest that as part of our music tour in 2017, we actually visited Beethoven's house in Bonn. We had a tour around the house, and we all got to see his piano. Unfortunately, we weren't allowed to play it, which is a bit of a shame, but I think it's a bit delicate for us to all have a little go. So that's Beethoven's house in Bonn, where he lived for the first 22 years of his life with his family. So he studied music in Bonn through his teens. He was a very successful young musician, but he wasn't quite the prodigy that his father wanted him to be. He wasn't quite like Mozart was, internationally renowned by the time he was sort of, you know, 10 years old. But he was a very successful musician, a student musician. He studied the music of Bach while he was in Bonn, and Bach's an important influence on Beethoven. But in 1792, he travels to Vienna. He travels to Vienna to begin lessons with Haydn, who is a sort of at the time probably the most famous composer on the planet. And he's a really revered musician. And Vienna at the time is the sort of like cultural capital of Europe. It's a real hotbed for artists, musicians, painters, literature, whatever. I mean, it really is an important sort of like cultural focal point of Europe. Beethoven was only supposed to go and study with Haydn temporarily, and then he was supposed to return to Bonn to take up a musical post there, but he never did. He became renowned as a fine musician and composer and pianist in Vienna, and he never goes back to live in Bonn. His home is then based in Vienna for pretty much the rest of his life. And what happens is he receives patronage from important wealthy patrons. So if you've studied your history, you may have come across the concept of patronage before. This is the idea that people almost like sponsor you to write music. So Beethoven didn't have to get a job as such. He had some piano pupils and so on and so forth, but he didn't have to get like a musical post anywhere. He was able to just compose, and people would pay him money to compose, which is a great way of making a living. All that he did in return was he would name pieces after the person that had sponsored or provided the patronage to him. And his first sort of, I suppose, important patron was Prince Karl Lichnowsky. I think I pronounced that right. Lichnowsky was a wealthy prince living in Vienna, and he actually put Beethoven up in an apartment of his when he first moved. And lots of Beethoven's early pieces are dedicated to Prince Karl. Now, two letters form a really important part of Beethoven's life. The first one, written in 1802, is the Heiligenstadt Testament. And this first letter is written to his brothers. So you've got Johann and Karl, two of his brothers. It's a bit of a tale of woe, if I'm honest with you. Beethoven was a complex character. He wasn't a straightforward man. And part of the problem was that he quite early on in his life realised that his hearing wasn't very good. And from the age of about sort of 25 onwards, he starts to go slowly deaf. So by 1802, his hearing is already pretty bad. Now, as a musician, composer, that's obviously fairly devastating, and it reveals a great deal about his mental state. So what we're going to do now is we're going to have a little reading of an extract from this letter, and I have a guest reader for us. I'm not going to tell you who it is, but this guest reader has done a great job of reading this letter for us, so I hope that you enjoy this. This is Beethoven's Heiligenstadt Testament.
An extract from Beethoven's letter to his brothers, written in 1802, but was never delivered. For my brothers, Karl and Johann Beethoven. Oh, you men who think or say that I am malevolent, stubborn, or misanthropic, how greatly you do wrong me! You do not know the secret cause which makes me seem that way to you. From childhood on, my heart and soul have been full of the tender feeling of goodwill, and I was even inclined to accomplish great things. But think that for 6 years now I have been hopelessly afflicted, made worse by senseless physicians, from year to year deceived with hopes of improvement, finally compelled to face the prospect of a lasting malady, whose cure will take years, or perhaps be impossible. Though born with a fiery, active temperament, even susceptible to the diversions of society, I was soon compelled to isolate myself, to live life alone. If at times I try to forget all of this, oh, how harshly was I flung back by the doubly sad experience of my bad hearing! Yet it was impossible for me to say to people, "Speak louder, shout, for I am deaf." Oh, how could I possibly admit an infirmity in the one sense which ought to be more perfect in me than others? A sense which I once possessed in the highest perfection, a perfection such as few in my profession enjoy or have ever enjoyed. Oh, how happy I shall be if I can still be helpful to you in my grave. Ah, so be it. With joy I hasten towards death. If it comes before I have had the chance to develop all my artistic capacities, it will still be coming too soon, despite my harsh fate. And I should probably wish it yet later. Yet even so, I should be happy. For would it not free me from a state of endless suffering? Come when thou wilt, I shall meet thee bravely. Farewell, and do not wholly forget me when I am dead. I deserve this from you, for during my lifetime I was thinking of you often, and of ways to make you happy. Be so. Ludwig van Beethoven, October the 6th, 1802.
Did you recognise our guest reader there? Thank you very much, Mr. Lewis, for doing a great job. It's definitely better to hear him read something like that than it is me. So it's really interesting because you see Beethoven, he really presents himself as a tormented soul. His mental state is very, very poor, and his hearing is obviously really troubling him. You know, he's sort of talking about how a musician who can hear music like he can, sort of in his head, how can it be so that his hearing can then fail? I mean, he's talking about hastening towards death. This letter's written in 1802. It's actually 1827 when he dies. So he's perhaps a little bit premature here, but he doesn't come across as a particularly jolly chap. That's really interesting to hear someone who's so gifted and so talented actually reveal that personally they were really quite tormented. The other curious thing about this is that Beethoven, as Mr. Lewis said before he started reading, Beethoven actually never sent this letter. So this letter was found in his personal possessions after he died. But anyway, I think it's really interesting. It reveals his sort of like mental fragility, even though he's a one of the best musicians who's ever lived. Now, we have a second letter, which is written 10 years later in 1812 to my immortal beloved. We don't know who this is written to. So unlike the other letter, which is quite clearly addressed to his brothers, no one knows who he was writing this letter to, but he clearly loved this lady. There's a possibility that it might have been Josephine Brunswick, who he wrote other love letters to, but they weren't perhaps quite so overtly passionate as this. And again, this letter was not sent. It was found in his personal possessions after he died. So it's really curious that these two letters both have that in common. Now, again, rather than me read it, we have guest readers for this. So that's fantastic because it'll sound much more interesting than listening to me. So I'd like to say thank you to Evelyn, thank you to Lillian, and thank you to Jack, who are going to read us extracts from Beethoven's To My Immortal Beloved.
6th of July, morning. My angel, my all, my own self. Only a few words today, and that too with pencil, with yours. Only till tomorrow is my lodging definitely fixed. What abominable waste of time in such things. Why this deep grief, where necessity speaks?
Can our love persist otherwise than through sacrifices, than by not demanding everything? Canst thou change it, that thou art not entirely mine, I am not entirely thine? O God, look into beautiful nature and compose your mind to the inevitable. Love demands everything and is quite right, so it is for me with you, for you with me. Only you forget so easily that I must live for you and for me. Were we quite united, you would notice this painful feeling as little as I should.
We shall probably soon meet. Even today I cannot communicate my remarks to you, which during these days I made about my life. Where our hearts close together, I should probably not make any such remarks. My bosom is full to tell you much. There are moments when I find that speech is nothing at all. Brighten up, remain my true and only treasure, my all, as I to you. The rest the gods must send, what must be for us and shall. Yours faithful, Ludwig.
Monday evening. 6th of July. You suffer, you my dearest creature. Just now I perceive the letters that must be posted first thing early. Mondays, Thursdays, the only days when the post goes from here to K. You suffer. Oh, where I am, you are with me. With me and you. I shall arrange that I may live with you. What a life. So, without you pursued by the kindness of the people here and there, whom I mean to desire to earn just as little as they earn, humility of man towards men, it pains me. and when I regard myself in connection with the universe, what I am and what he is, whom calls the greatest, and yet there lies herein again the godlike of man, I weep when I think you will only probably receive on Saturday the first news from me, as you two love, yet I love you stronger. But never hide yourself from me. Good night, as I am taking the waters, I must go to bed. O God, so near, so far. It's not a real building of heaven, I love, but as firm too as the citadel of heaven.
Good morning on 7th of July. Even in bed my ideas yearn towards you, my immortal beloved, here and there joyfully, then again sadly, awaiting from fate whether it will listen to us. I can only live either altogether with you or not at all. Yes, I've determined to wander about for so long far away until I can fly into your arms and call myself quite at home with you, can turn my soul enveloped by yours into the realm of spirits. Yes, I regret it must be. You will get over it all the more as you know my faithfulness to you. Never another one can own my heart, never, never. O God, why must one go away from the one love so, and yet in my life double you, as it is now, is a miserable life. Your love made me the happiest and unhappiest at the same time. At my actual age, I should need some continuity, sameness as a life. Can that exist under our circumstances? Angel, I just hear that the post goes out every day, and must close, therefore, that you get the L at once. Be calm, love me, today, yesterday.
What longing and tears for you, you, my life, my all, farewell. Oh, go on loving me, never doubt the faithfulest heart. Of your beloved, L, ever thine, ever mine, ever ours.
So there you go. Wow, what a powerful and passionate letter Beethoven writes there. Really interesting that we don't know exactly who it was written to. It's fascinating, isn't it? So, to wrap up this first little bit, what can you do next? Well, there's a variety of different things you can do. Hopefully you've filled in the first page of the Beethoven workbook as you've gone here. That's what I sort of recommended you did in my written post. But if you haven't, you could print that out or download that and fill that in. There's then the first of the three Beethoven quizzes to have a go at in the assignments tabs. By the time you get there, if there's more than one quiz on there, don't do all three to start with. You just need to do the first quiz for this first video. What else could you do? You could discover a lot more about Beethoven's life. The website, the top one there I've recommended, Beethoven for Kids, is a great one. There's loads of stuff to click on, look at, read up about. It's really interactive. It's really good. The Classic FM ones are both great. So if you want to discover a little bit more about where Beethoven lived and how he lived in Bonn and what his lifestyle was like, the timeline's a good one, and then just more about his general life. Now, what you could also do is listen to some bits of Beethoven. So far, I've talked about Beethoven. We've not actually heard any of Beethoven's music. So I'm going to put that right by playing a little snippet of the Beethoven's Moonlight Sonata, a piano sonata that he wrote. But I've recommended a couple of other recordings there. So Beethoven's First and Third Symphonies are both brilliant pieces, are really important pieces. The Third Symphony we're going to come back to in the next video and have a little bit more of a longer look at it. So get delving into who Beethoven was, have a listen to some of his amazing music, find out a bit more about his lifestyle and about these letters if you want. Go away, see if you can dig up some more about that, because they're really interesting. But just to finish with, here's a bit of Beethoven's Moonlight Sonata, and I've got a feeling that a lot of you will go, oh yeah, I've heard this before. Here we go then. Thank you. There, I wonder if you did recognise that. It's a really famous piece of piano music. So I hope that you found that interesting and that you might have learned a little bit about who Beethoven was and a little bit about his interesting personality and life. And we're going to follow that up with two more of these in which we're going to look a little bit more about how he composed and study some specific pieces in more detail. Thank you.